In today's episode of the Pathfinder Presents podcast, I have a very interesting guest here with me today. I'm with Jeff Hedrich, and he is basically heading up a very interesting, it's product process. It's a very interesting new approach that the folks of the team has been coming up with and has been establishing in the market, obviously, over a long period of time. We're talking today about brand scan process, and we're going to be learning what this is all about and what the team around Jeff has been learning over the recent years to really, you know, bring that process into the market. So Jeff, welcome to the show.
Good morning, Lucas. Thanks for having me.
Very good. So maybe, you know, give us a 360 overview. What is brand scan process all about?
Well, obviously, Lucas, as you know, over the last decade, data and technology have totally revolutionized one-to-one marketing, right? That was often considered the holy grail. When you could target one customer for a specific product at a specific time, that was something that was sought for a long time. I'm a veteran of the ad industry. Well, that time has come, and it's obviously really revolutionized one-to-one marketing. However, branding is still practiced today, much as it was back in the 1960s. We all know the Showtime show ad men about the heyday of Madison Avenue. How they did branding then and how they do it now is largely the same. So the brand scan process is all about marrying data and technology, especially data, to create a truly data-driven branding process. So that's what we're doing for companies to grow market share, increase revenues, you know, and so forth.
And for everybody who's listening in, who wants to sort of, you know, get a gist on whether it is sort of right for them or if they're too early or too late, like, you know, what's the typical company that benefits, you know, from this process, or the typical people within the companies that actually have an eye on this process?
Yeah, so it's really aimed at private enterprise. We work with companies as small as 1 million in revenue. We've done clients as large as 500 million in revenue. There's really two kind of parties that'll be interested in it. Certainly marketing, you know, folks in the responsible for the branding and marketing of their companies, but also CEOs who really care about increasing brand value, who understand that brand is, you know, not only far more than a logo, but goes beyond marketing. It really helps set the strategy for forward-thinking companies. So those are the two kind of roles within a company, private enterprise and both marketers and C-suite people, especially CEOs and presidents.
Makes sense. And you know, how do you think about the process of somebody getting to know the brand scan process and getting started? Because, you know, obviously they have to sort of hear about you guys. They have to get familiarized with the process. They would see other successful companies. You know, maybe can you tell me about the journey or the channels of people getting started with the process?
Sure. We built a pretty good following, at least for myself, on LinkedIn. You can find me at Jeff Hedrich. And you're going to find there a series of episodes called Branding Hacks. Insights into how to really use and create a data-driven branding practice, right? And they're fun, they're informative, they're pretty interesting. They rank from three minutes to 5 minutes. We're about to launch a YouTube channel also the beginning of August, and our URL, brandscanprocess.com. And then a lot of outreach, working perhaps with a company like yours to do some of the things, because it's kind of funny. I don't know, Lucas, you know the saying that the doctor's son never gets any medical care, right? Sometimes a marketer isn't good at marketing themselves. So while we certainly do a lot ourselves, we're going to be looking for partners to help us once we really launch this product. I should mention, we've been using this process for a decade with our ad agency. What's happened is demand for the process has outstripped demand for our, you know, typical agency services. So instead of competing with agencies, competing with consultancies, we're focusing on the brand scan process as a standalone process. We conduct remotely via Zoom with the focus group and the other aspects, so we never have to meet with clients. Whether the pandemic hopefully goes away totally or not, makes it very convenient. And it's generally a 4-week process.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of agencies that we have on the show are very reliant on referrals, and obviously, you know, if the quality of the work is there. Now you have brandscanprocess.com. Like, what role do you attribute to the website moving forward? Is it like a client acquisition vehicle? Is it an information brochure? Like, how do you think about it?
Yeah, it's a little bit of both, you know, obviously. We do think that we have a lot of thought leadership. And some of that content, again, you're going to find at LinkedIn. Of course, we have to push that out. Some you're going to find at YouTube. Some you're going to find on our site. And you're right. We also are believing that at some point there's going to be a public relations strategy. You know, obviously with the only data-driven branding process for the market, I'm not saying no agency has a philosophy approach, but there's a quote that we like from a gentleman. He says, if you can't describe what you're doing as a process, you don't know what you're doing. This is a very linear sequential process. And the idea is that people tend to think of brands as sort of opinion-driven. What do I think? What do you think? But really, Lucas, every brand is comprised of two key core elements: attributes of the product, company, or service, and the customer benefits derived from those attributes. We have discovered there are only really 9 master categories of attributes, like customer service, price, assurance, things like that, and 43 subcategories. That allows us, is the basis, not the whole thing, to create this data-driven branding practice that works for every brand and every industry category. So for example, Lucas, we work with Humtown, is a global manufacturer in the 3D space, right? We work with them because their brand is comprised of attributes and elements. Farmers National Bank is a community bank. It's a leading community bank in Ohio, one of the leaders in the nation. We also work with a large furniture store. So because all brands are composed of attributes and benefits, we don't have to have specific industry expertise. We are experts in branding, not in a specific industry.
Now, I really love when it comes up in the show that, you know, experts in a particular field, they kind of unlock the frameworks behind. And it's exactly what you guys are doing. Yeah. So that's super interesting. So the framework for branding is how I understand it so far from the interview. Yeah. Super interesting. I would love to switch gears slightly and pick your brain a little about sort of your general perspective on marketing, right? Because we you know, get very great marketers here on the show. Right. What would you personally think, like, especially with maybe an innovative process like yourself and established as well, what is the biggest challenge bringing sort of a new innovation when it comes to marketing into the market?
Yeah, so Lucas, I think you're on it. We all know that generally your opportunity is your challenge and your challenge is your opportunity. And what I mean by that is we have this new and very different way of doing it. That's our opportunity. The challenge is no one's familiar that there really is a data-driven branding process. This is an entirely different way of doing it. So yeah, that is it. On the one hand, I just mentioned thought leadership, and we have real thought leadership and proven, but at the same standpoint, no one yet is, you know, most people aren't yet familiar with it and how to do it. So that's where education, but it can't be education like, you know, my daughter is going to be going to college soon. It's going to be in college for 4 years. Well, I don't want to wait 4 years, right, until people really understand my process. So finding ways to quickly communicate what it is we do, how it's different, and of course, why it's effective is crucial. So then you're looking for the ways to do that. Is it LinkedIn? Is it having a website that, as your company helps companies like ours make our website more productive when we gain visitors? Because if someone comes to my website, I don't convert them, I'm pretty disappointed, right? Obviously, I feel I have a process that's unlike anything else they've ever used, but, you know, am I conveying the right information? Am I giving the right kind of calls to action, right? And so, yeah, that is a challenge. And so again, we're excited. We have something, again, revolutionary, we believe. The companies that have worked for us are all willing to say it really is. It's transformed some of them. But right, we want to get the word out nationally on the truth of this. And it's going to be a challenge like it is for anybody with something that's great, but yet not yet has the recognition that you'd like to have.
Makes complete sense. Like, we had more and more teams, actually marketing teams, were sort of, you know, docking on to sales to form revenue teams. So the, you know, the ROI or the money that is being, how you spend at marketing is, you know, looked at much more closer. It's what we noticed in the interviews recently. How do you think about, just very generically in the arena of marketing, about sort of, you know, customer acquisition cost and what marketing, which role should it play in there?
Yeah. So I guess there's two things. Obviously, you want to track everything that you can. However, you also want to remember your goal is not tracking. Your goal is growth and acquisition. Here's what I mean. So for example, for many of our clients that we have that are in the retail space, television is still a very, television ads, the classic 30 and 15 second ads is still a very, you know, effective overall vehicle. However, it's a lot more difficult to track every specific ad and what it brings in versus digital ads, where I can say, got this many clicks, this many conversions. Nonetheless, I can tell you that when we've spent money with clients over the course of a year, that client rather spent that money, overall, we can prove that television overall has been more effective because of their growth in their sales, even though we can't track those individual TV spots. So the first thing is, remember, the goal is not tracking, the goal is growth. However, whenever you can track, of course you want to do that, right? Does that make sense to you? Do you follow that line of thought?
100%. I was actually just thinking that could be the sort of the quote of the interview. The goal is not tracking, the goal is growth. I really like that.
Right. Yes, exactly. And then sometimes tracking is effective, but sometimes, unfortunately, it's not. Eventually, probably all will be trackable. But right now, for example, that medium, billboards, you can't really prove what they convert. And yet I have clients in certain markets that doing very well. And billboards are a significant, you know, part of their marketing strategy. So,
Yeah. Let's switch gears a bit and you know, talk about maybe your own journey. I mean, you alluded to the agency already. You guys have years of experience. You're extracting a process out of an agency. I think that typically tends to be the strongest companies that were born out of a real need and a real problem. Maybe tell us at the moment, right? Getting up a new product, having the agency, being, you know, obviously busy building those teams. How do you find time to educate yourself? Like, you know, where do you spend time? Like, how do you filter information? Maybe tell us a bit about that.
Yeah, so it is very difficult because you're busy doing, and then you're not spending enough time thinking or taking in thinking that others are doing, right? So obviously, traditionally, I'm looking at the ad ages, the ad weeks, you know, the content they push out. You're on LinkedIn, you know, you're at those places. And obviously the pandemic hurt some of the one-to-one interaction, you know, you might have in the marketplace when you go to restaurants or bars or wherever you meet people in your field. That's hard. So it's just, I think it's more just an understanding and a commitment. And hey, this is generally perceived, the marketing industry, as a young person's business, right? And why is that? Well, I think it's because often older folks, they get to a point where they think they know what they need to know. They're no longer curious. They're no longer interested. They don't want to adapt. You know, I have the exact opposite mindset. You know, I don't mind saying I'm 61 years old now. I feel fresh. I love to work with younger people, not because I don't like people my own age, but because they're still curious and interested. I happen to have a daughter. She's 16. She keeps me young, right? Her usage of social media, she's always on to the next thing, right? So I think more than anything, it's about a commitment to be curious and interested, to understand you can always learn more, and then you'll find those venues through which, you know, you can find out more. Now, it's also important to kind of recognize the difference between a fad and a true trend, right? So something comes along, you know, certainly there's been a lot of things digital that have been ballyhooed, and then we found out, that really wasn't the way to go forward, right? So you're trying to make sure you can distinguish as early as you can. This is really going to work. There's something fundamentally wrong with this.
Yeah, no, I think a lot of wisdom in there. I love to see in the interviews when actually the both worlds come together, because in the end, the principles remain, you know, the vehicles change in a way, the technology changes.
That's a good way of saying it. Yeah, I agree.
Very good. Jeff, since we're slowly approaching the end of the interview, I would love to jump into our rapid fire questions. Are you ready for those?
I am.
What's the last book that you read?
The last book that I read, I'm going to remember the title of it now, is Churchill's Ministry of Ungentlemanly Warfare. It's basically the role that spies played for Great Britain in World War II. I admire Churchill as a leader, and this was about kind of how you use unconventional means to defeat the Nazis.
Interesting. What's one single thing that your company is focused on the most at the moment?
Yeah, it is data-driven branding. Sorry to sound like a broken record, but it's all about data-driven branding.
If there would be no boundaries in technology, what's the one thing you want to have fixed for your role today?
I would like, would you repeat that question? I want to make sure I answer correctly.
There is no boundaries anymore. Technology can do it all. Yeah. What's the one thing you want to fix for your role?
For my role? The use of a hologram, like, you know, virtual reality tool, which I know Microsoft has been ballyhooing, where you could have meetings in which you really do, even more than this Zoom, you really experience being in the room with one another, having much more ability to get feedback from a large group. They've been talking about it. It's been, the release date has been pushed back. The HoloLens 2, I think it's called. And I'm really curious to see if that happens, if it's going to even improve, you know, our ability to have these kind of virtual meetings. So it'd be that tool.
Mm-hmm. What's the last thing that kept you awake at night about the company?
Well, obviously during the pandemic, you know, there was a time when I wondered, are we going to go under? You know, are we really going to make it? Are we going to survive? We had some clients who were essential businesses. There was a time I thought, okay, how am I going to take care of my daughter? What's going to happen to my employees? You know, what's the world coming to? And obviously we feel we're mostly on the other side of that. Our business has certainly bounced back, but I know some friends whose companies did not recover, and I feel for them, and there's no shame in that. You know, that was not their fault what happened, and you know, God bless them, and I'm hoping that, you know, I can be part of the solution of that. Mm-hmm.
And the last question, sort of for the rapid fire, I love the most. You know, if we zoom back, what is it, like 20, 27 years now when the company started? If you, you know, zoom yourself back, put yourself back in the first day starting the company, I don't know if you started in a little office or a garage, I don't know.
Yeah, a tiny little office the size of a closet.
Very good. So my question would be, what's the one advice that you would give yourself if you could talk to yourself back then?
I'd say, you know, Jeff, you know so much less than you think you know. You need to be more patient with others. You need to more quickly recognize when you're wrong, more quickly apologize for being wrong, be kinder, generally speaking. But at the same time, understand that, you know, God has been, it will be gracious to you. He'll help you overcome your faults and mistakes and, you know, go after it. And so it's not about not going, not being ambitious, but just being kinder along the way, I think.
It's very, very interesting and a nice way to put it. Jeff, I really appreciate that you took the time with us today to share a little bit more about, you know, data-driven brand development. I want to give you the very last word of the show. If somebody would be forgetting all that we discussed about the brand scan process, what's the one thing that they should remember?
The branding can be today, we kind of think how to better say that, that there is an ongoing revolution in branding. I'm sure that we're just a part of it. I like to think that we're kind of the, you know, that first wave, but there's a better way to do branding that has been done. The data does work when it comes to branding, that branding doesn't have to be this mysterious black press, black box process. And you should turn to, of course, brandscanprocess.com to find that solution.
Awesome. Thanks for being a guest on Pathfinder Presents.
All right. Thank you. Appreciate it.